Jesus both are talking about living under failed leadership. Religious and political leadership for both of them. For Ezekiel, he is watching, already in exile in Babylon, the siege and destruction of the city of Jerusalem and the temple of God. Ezekiel has a vision in which the presence of God leaves the temple. And as it leaves, he sees corruption of religious worship, the corruption of theology through idolatry in many forms. But for Ezekiel, there is a worse infraction, a worse failure of leadership. Even then, people having fallen away from the faithful worship of God. And it is how people are treating each other. Ezekiel is a priest and a prophet, and he's very concerned with right worship, with right belief. And he is terribly distressed at the way that the temple of God has been desecrated through idolatry. But in his understanding, and this is true for all of the prophets in the Old Testament, these expressions of faithlessness, this corruption of religious leadership and of worship, is rooted in something far more important. And it is how people treat each other. Ezekiel says, if you do violence in the land, if you do not care for those who are most vulnerable, then it doesn't matter how good your prayers are, how beautiful your sermons are, how eloquent your scripture readings are. It doesn't matter how good your worship is if you mistreat one another. Your worship is corrupt. And he watches the destruction of Jerusalem and the temple, rooted faithlessness of the people to one another and thus to God. Centuries later, Jesus is teaching. Under Roman occupation, under the rule of the Roman Empire, in a constant conflict with the corruption of religious leadership in his own day, going to teach in the temple that was rebuilt after the people had gone into exile, going to try to help people connect with God in a new way, trying to bring people into the presence of God, but watching them mistreat each other and destroy each other, and thus fail to know what God is doing. And in Matthew 25, in this very challenging passage, a passage that comes right before we enter into Jesus' passion, right before we enter into the narrative of his arrest and trial and crucifixion and death, Jesus tells a story that comes straight out of Ezekiel chapter 34. He says, at the end of time, we will be judged. And we will stand before our eternal judge. And the question that will be asked of us is, how did we treat one another? How did we treat one another? Some of us will have gone to Sunday school every Sunday, read devotionals every day of the week, called out to the name of Jesus every day of our lives. But the way that we treated one another will reveal that we never really knew God. And others of us will be confused. We won't recognize where we are. We won't understand who this God is before us because we struggle to believe. We struggled to come on a Sunday morning. We failed in our religious practice in so many ways. And yet the way we treated other people revealed where it mattered most. We knew God. We knew God in each other. And we cared for each other. Jesus says to those who are confused that they are being welcomed by God, "Wherever you did it to the least of these, you did it to me." So both for Ezekiel and for Jesus, both living in times of failed religious and political leadership, they ground the meaning of our life just in this. How we treat one another reveals what we really believe about God. And maybe every age is a time of failed leadership. It's hard for me to think of one in the course of human history that wasn't, where both religious and political leaders failed us. I was in such a time just a few years ago. I was working at another church, a church that was ripping itself apart over what was right. The argument is one that we are very familiar with, one that matters, one that I have a strong opinion about, as everybody else does, but one that is guaranteed to rip congregations apart if left without care, was the question of same-gender relationships and the definition of marriage, something sacred and very controversial. And this church where I was serving was tearing itself to shreds over fights about what was right and what was wrong and what God wanted, what the will of God was, what the right way to know God was. People leaving the church and arguing in the church, withholding their gifts from the church, people speaking badly about their own church in the community, all over this terrible fight over what they thought was right and what they thought was wrong, what they thought God wanted. It's not that the issue wasn't important. It's very important. And it's very difficult, as so many of the issues that we argue about are. So much to disagree on. So much to argue about. And so difficult to hear an opposing point of view. Because how in the world can that be right? How can you not see how right I am? Why don't you understand the world the way that I do? When are you getting it through your thick skull? So difficult to talk about these controversial things. So difficult to find any common ground. But in the midst of our unholy arguments, we were tearing each other apart, reckless with our relationships and with our feelings towards one another, reckless with friendships that had been built up over decades, willing to malign one another and attack one another over our idea of God, careless of the people who stood right in front of us. It was the end of a long, long day of this fighting, a Friday evening. I'd been working at the church all week and all day, and I was the last one to leave. I was so tired and so angry. Things were so rough, and I was working so hard, and so many other people were working so hard, and what were we going to do? And it was Friday evening. My wife had been calling me. My kids were already in bed. What was the point of all of this? So very grudgingly, very frustratedly, I walked out of the church, shut off the lights, locked up the doors, and began to walk down the sidewalk to my car. And a woman stepped out from behind the building. She was old. She was dressed in ragged clothes. An old black woman walking down the street towards me, calling out to me, "Sir, do you have some food?" she asks me that question, I'm going to yell at her. I had put in such a week's work and such a day's work, and my family was angry with me because I wasn't home. And all the people that I tried to help were angry with me because I hadn't helped them in the way that they wanted to be helped. And here, as I'm finally getting out the door, this woman comes up to me from down the street. Sir, do you have some food? How many people can you help in a day? So angry. And I bit my lip and turned back to her and said, ma'am, we don't really keep food here. Here are some places you can go. And I listed off soup kitchens that I knew were closed, homeless shelters that were probably full, all these services that were there, but that I doubted would actually be able to help her very much. She said, yes, I know some of those places, but I'm so hungry. Do you have anything?